This setting, this age group is a totally new
experience.
So before I start, right, I want to do a short exercise. So actually, I'm focused on brain working, not my brain working, I think. So I need to borrow your phone.
You guys experience what?
like this Sunday our psalm is Psalm 23 years ago. The Lord is my shepherd every day. So today's gospel this Sunday's gospel we look at God reveals himself his face as a king. How do we relate to a king? You know, like, most of the time he gives us a face which is something we can relate to in our life, as a friend. A friend can, you know, like Tommy always talks about like consoling the heart of Jesus and that kind of thing. So as a shepherd, we have sheep, so we'll follow him, he'll keep us safe wherever we go. But as a king, it's a bit fuzzier because in our age today we don't really know. You don't really meet kings, you don't read them. You know, in the old days, it's a very serious affair. If you disrespect a king, you can get killed. So, if your head is gone, it's the end. You're in the dungeons. So, let's try to see the face of God as a king in this gospel. Is it a volunteer?
You want me to read?
Okay.
Jesus began to speak to the chief priests and elders of the people in parables. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a feast for his son's wedding. He sent his servants to call those who had been invited, but they would not come. Next, he sent some of his servants. Tell those who have been invited, he said, that I have my banquet all prepared, my oxen and fattened cattle have been slaughtered, everything is ready. Come to the wedding. But they were not interested. One went off to his farm, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, maltreated them, and killed them. Yeah, the king was furious. He dispatched his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their town. Then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready. But as those who were invited proved to be unworthy, go to the crossroads in the town and invite everyone you can find to the wedding. So these servants went out onto the roads and collected together everyone they could find, bad and good alike. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. When the king came in to look at the guests, he noticed one man who was not wearing a wedding garment and said to him, how do you get in here, my friend, without a wedding garment? And the man was silent. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him and hand and foot and throw him out into the dark where there will be weeping and grinding of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. Yeah.
The Lord. Thank you. So, from here we see God is a just king. We see his righteous anger. So, you know, really, this gospel is scary. Suddenly we see the Old Testament God again, that becomes angry and he kills people. Angry and he sends people to war. How do we reconcile these images of God? We look at Jesus who is gentle and kind. And then it comes back again to the idea of righteousness. That he is the just king. Because anger in itself is not evil, it's just it's the right response to injustice. So the second part, we see the guest on the street. It's like, since you're going to come, it's invite anybody else. Go to the streets, the villains, any good on that line. Everyone is invited. So that refers to Christians, refers to the new followers of Christ. Because the invitation is now extended to everybody. And it speaks to God's generosity. His generosity is the king that his door is open to everybody. And then finally we have the underdressed case. But the guy came in and then the king was walking around and he sees this guy who's not wearing the wedding garment. So in those times, it's actually customary, so that when the king sends the invitation to the banquet, he will send the attire, the correct attire as well, the garment and everything. So it's actually quite a big snub, like, if you refuse to wear it. So after all the trouble has gone to give that to you already. So this refers to our baptismal garment. It's the sign of his lordship when we put on Christ, when we admitted to the support of them. So when I reflected on this, what I drew from this is that God is a proud king. Not in a negative sense, but he's proud of his kingdom, he's proud of his subjects. So he wants the best in them. So it's like Saint Irenaeus says, the glory of God is manifold. So, you know why you worship him? I think you're familiar with these times, I won't go too much into them. But the different ways that we honor the saints by Mary. What's the difference between Judea and Austria? You know, is it just a degree, you just honor God more than everyone else? Or is it something that's a totally different way of creating freedom, if you think? So I was struck when I looked up the Greek meanings of it. So Judea means servitude, which is the honor given among servants. Your honor, like this person is doing well. I respect that he does his job well. You honor him that way. And I was very touched by what Austria means, which is the state of a higher servant. Which means it's the relationship between us as a servant to our master. It's a totally different degree of dignity. Give all that honor to him as creation to creator, as servant to master, as subject to king. So when we worship God, we honor him as our king, and we take our place as his servants. So we adopt this identity. is his subject. Something amazing happens because we are we share in that glory. We share in that kingdom and victory. Because if you're not in that kingdom, I mean the victory is not yours. You're just observer, spectator to grace. But God invites us to be a participant. Scared of God, having that sensitivity to the spirit, or having that sense of God, of who He is. So it kind of makes sense that every other grace stems from there. When we place ourselves at our true identity in Christ, our identity in creation. So, in order to truly worship, to lay ourselves down at His feet, begins with this gift. So, as we wrap things up with, God is just, He's generous, and He's a proud King. We are called to share in His glory. We honor Him by daring to be His symbol, by putting red eyes on us. So, I want to backtrack a bit, because I think we talked about the garment here. What is your Christ? Things, why would it be so difficult to wear it? What would it be a burden? You know, right? I mean, it's really given to you, why would you deny it? Doesn't seem to make sense, right? That's because when you wear something which is a symbol, it weighs on you. So, like, you know, this week I went for reservist. So I had to bring up my army uniform. First thing was, my new friends, everything. But I think what I hate most about having to wear my uniform out is that people look at you. People look at you like, oh, this guy is a soldier, and then they have expectations. Like, you know, you cannot be sitting down on the reserve seat. You end up on a storm, and then big hoo-ha will come. So that's the burden of the invisible garment. Because people will look to you and say, is this person really a follower of Christ? Is this person really loving? Is this person really good enough? And sometimes our temptation is to say, no, I'm not good enough. So I will not wear this. And so we deny ourselves grace. We deny ourselves the chance to experience God's love when it comes to us with everything we don't deserve. So before we go into sharing, I want to look again at the three things that you listed. So we need to add heaven to that list. So we need to look at each item we need to add. And ask yourself, which of these, and bring that from the one you are most willing to suffer from. And the one you are least willing to suffer, to the one you are least willing to suffer from. Something in the mind for it, to sacrifice something for it, you don't really want. So the one, the thing that you hated first, that they really, that you suffered the most. That's the king of our lives right now. Because when we are a servant, when we follow a king, we lay down our lives for the king. So, living here, let's go into some reflection and think about how do we restore God as our king, as the rightful king on his rightful throne. Thank you.